All right, everybody, welcome to lecture 25 of quantum mechanics part one. I'm live streaming the class because apparently some people are having difficulty watching or joining the class. All right. Okay, so, and also, any questions from last time? Let me just go over that really quickly, what I talked about last time. So we are talking about the quantum harmonic oscillator, and this, what I said was that we have this expression for the harmonic oscillator, and we write this as some object, some capital P and capital X. And then this expression is a square plus b square. So it can be factored as a plus ib times a minus ib, right? Okay, now we can use the commutation relation. Suraj, anything you want to share with me, man? Suraj?
No, sir.
Anything you want to share? No? Nothing? Okay.
No, sir, no.
Checking. No? Okay. So then we can use the commutation relations to find the commutator of A and B. The commutator of A and B turns out to be a constant, right? And what is A and B? This is this linear combination, P plus Ix and P minus Ix. And then using that, we can write the Hamiltonian as the sum of AB and A plus B. And using the commutation relation again, we can write it as BA plus B prime by 2. So like I said, what is B prime? What is B? B is a creation operator. A is an annihilation operator, right? What does it annihilate and create? It annihilates and creates the eigenstates of the Hamiltonian. So today we'll work out in proper, in full detail what happens. Okay, so first of all, what we want to do is we want to write down, so we have this Hamiltonian. Okay, now in the previous lecture, what I did was I just wrote this object as p square and this object as x square, right? It is actually helpful to write down dimensionless operators, right? So what do we mean by writing something that is dimensionless? So this has, what are the dimensions of this, right? Dimensions of H are the dimensions of energy, right? And what is energy? Well, energy is H bar omega, right? And in this case, what is omega? Omega is root K by M, right? So let's try to write this expression as follows. H bar omega, right? Let's factor out H bar omega. What will we get over here? P square by 2m H bar omega plus K over 2 H bar omega X square, right? Now, what is the dimension of these operators? P square divided by 2m H bar omega. They are dimensionless, right? They have to be dimensionless, right? Okay. So now we can do the following. We define the following operators. A is equal to, so here you notice that there is a factor of 2m H bar omega, right? So I get 2m h bar omega, okay? and then x square x, then I have to put an extra factor of m omega, right? Because this guy doesn't have. So when you look at k by h bar omega, what is k? K is equal to m omega square over h bar omega, right? So we can write this as m omega by h bar. Let me rewrite the Hamiltonian. H bar omega p square by 2m. Again, if my connection breaks at any point, you cannot hear me, please let me know. So k by h bar omega is equal to m omega by 2h bar x square. Okay? Right? So we define this operator A to be m omega x hat plus ip. Okay? And this is what will be our annihilation operator. And A dagger, this is dagger, okay, not plus. So this is the Hermitian adjoint. Now, if you take the adjoint of this, what will you get? You will just get m omega x hat minus ip, right? Why? Because x and p are both Hermitian operators. The only thing left is I. So when you take the Hermitian conjugate of I, you get minus I, right? And this thing is called the creation operator. Okay. Now, in terms of x, in terms of A and A dagger, we can write x is equal to, x hat is equal to root of h bar by 2m omega A plus A dagger. And y hat, sorry, not y hat, p hat. P hat is equal to minus I root of m omega h bar by 2 A minus A dagger. Okay. Now let's work out the commutation relation of these two operators, right? A and AB. So these operators are like the operators that I had discussed in the previous lecture, this the capital A and capital B, right? Of course, if you look at this expression also, if you look at this, these two expressions, you can see right away that B is equal to A dagger, right? Because A is a Hermitian operator, P is a Hermitian operator, X is a Hermitian operator. So when I take the Hermitian conjugate, I will get P, but there'll be there's an I, so I get a minus I and X, right? And so this expression that I got here, it can be written as A dagger A plus C by 2. Right. That is what we will find to be the case. Now, so let's calculate the commutation relations of A and A dagger. Okay. So what do I get? I get a factor of 1 by 2m h bar omega. Right. There are two factors here. I get two square roots. And then there is a commutator of m omega x hat plus ip hat, m omega x hat minus ip hat, okay? Now, I hope that all of you know how to calculate commutators. In case you don't, let me just remind you, what is a commutator? A commutator is this object, right? And a commutator, it is easy to check, has the following properties, right? It is linear in its arguments. So if you take the sum of two operators and take the commutator with another, right? The commutator of a sum is equal to the sum of the commutators. Similarly, if you take A plus B and let's say commutator with C plus D, what will you get? You will get A comma C, A comma D. Plus C comma D. Right? And then finally, there is a very useful identity, which is the following. If you have the product of two operators like this, and you take the commutator with another third one, you can write this as A, B, C, and here, please keep in mind that the ordering of operators is very important, right? So here A is to the left of B. So here A comes out on the left of this expression, and here B comes out on the right. And similarly, if you have BC, it's exactly the same. AC. Plus AB. Okay. So this is part of your homework too, okay? To prove these two identities. And it's quite easy to prove those identities, not difficult. Okay. So we can look at this commutator. What will it be? We'll get 1/2m. Okay, let me write that on a new page. Copy. Is equal to 1/2m h power omega. So we get the commutator of this with this, right? Because the commutator of x with itself is zero. Right, so we get the commutator of m omega x hat comma minus ip plus commutator of ip comma m omega x hat, right? And this expression you can rewrite as minus m omega x hat comma ip, right? Because commutator is anti-symmetric. So what do you get? M omega cancels out, right? You get one by h bar. You get minus I by h bar x comma p. And what is x comma p? That is equal to I h bar right? So this is equal to 1 right. So a dagger is 1. Okay, this is a very important result. And by the way, the majority of quantum mechanics, right? I mean, it sounds a little bit silly to say this, but almost all of physics, somebody once said this, is that most physics is just the harmonic oscillator applied at various levels of abstraction. So in almost anything that you do in physics, it's just harmonic oscillator plus correction, at least at the beginning, okay? So the harmonic oscillator is something that you should absolutely master, right? So this commutator is 1. And now in terms of these operators, we can again write down the Hamiltonian, right? So we have a dagger and we have X and P and all this. So we can write this as H bar omega, and we will get by 2 times AA dagger plus A dagger A. Right? So this is the same expression. This is what the expression was that we got in the previous class, right? And then again, we can use the commutation relation. So the commutation relation tells us that AA dagger is equal to 1 plus A dagger A. And by the way, this 1, when I say 1, what I actually mean is the identity, right? Not the number 1, but the identity. Because these are operators, they will act on some states, right? Okay. And so using this, this becomes H bar omega A dagger A plus 1/2. Okay, so this is our expression for the harmonic oscillator Hamiltonian. Okay, now again, as I said, there are in physics, of course, one should not in general memorize things, but there are some things, some expressions which occur so often that, you know, they, if you remember them, then it will just make your life that much easier. Okay. So these are a few of those expressions. Okay. So this one. All right. Now we can ask, what does Schrodinger's equation tell us? Schrodinger's equation tells us the following, right? That I have some state psi, and the Hamiltonian acting on psi is equal to E psi, okay? Now, at this point, I should just ask everybody once, does everybody understand what I'm doing when I write an expression of this form? Is there anybody for whom this expression is not clear? Because it sometimes happens, right, that one can not understand something very basic. And just because something is very basic doesn't mean that it is easy to understand. Basic just means that it is the foundation of everything else, right? So it is very important to understand this basic fact, right? So this is an eigenvalue equation. It takes many forms. This can take the form of, it can either be written as a matrix expression, or it can be written as a differential equation, right? Or you can work with it completely abstractly in terms of an operator, in terms of operators. That is what we are going to do in this case. So all these three are, you know, different descriptions of the same physics, right? So let's see how this operator expression will work. Right? So this times psi is equal to E psi, right? Now, we have this operator A dagger A, right? This is also written as N, and it's called the number operator. Okay. And we will see why it is called the number operator in a second. So first let us look at this expression. We can rewrite this expression as follows, right? A dagger A acting on psi bar on cat psi is equal to e by h bar omega minus 1/2 psi, right? So what is this quantity? This is the eigenvalue, right? This is the eigenvalue of A dagger A, right? Because this is an operator acting on a vector, gives me a number. This thing is a number, right? Times that vector, another vector. So this is the eigenvalue of A dagger A. Okay, so now let's write it as follows. What we want to find are eigenvalues of the number operator. We'll write it like this, okay? This is the eigenvalue, and psi n is the corresponding eigenstate, right? And we should label the eigenstate with the eigenvalue, no? Right? Because for each eigenvalue, you'll have one eigenstate, unless your operator is degenerate. If it's non-degenerate, then there will be one eigenvalue for one eigenstate. Right, so you can take each eigenstate and label it with that eigenvalue, right? And right now I have not said what this number n is. Okay, it's some number. It can be real number. Can it be a complex number? Let's ask ourselves the question: what is the Hermitian adjoint of A of n? So this is A dagger A, right? N. Then if I take the Hermitian adjoint of this, what do I get? I get again A dagger A, right? So N is a Hermitian operator, which means it will have real eigenvalues, right? So this has to be a real number. And again, let me just remind you that if you take any two operators, you take the adjoint, that is equal to the adjoint of the product is equal to the inverse of the product of the adjoints in the reverse order, right? Okay, now, but there is another aspect. Right now we have said it's a real number, right? But does it have to be, can it be a negative number, let's say, right? So what we can do is we can take the inner product, right? So we have this expression. Now what we can do is we can contract both sides with the Bra psi of n, right? So what do you get on the left side? You get psi of n hat psi of n, and on the right side you get n psi of n, right? That is equal to n psi of n squared, right? Right, and this psi of n squared is what? Psi of n squared is always greater than or equal to zero, right? Right, the scalar product is always positive definite. This is what we mean. So this is definiteness of the scalar product, right? Positive definite means it's either greater than, it's always non-zero. It's zero only when the vectors are identically equal to zero. Okay, so only for the zero vector is this quantity become an equality. Okay, now if you look at the LHS, right? It is this expression, right? Because this operator n is what? It's a dagger a. Right. Now, let me call a times psi of n to be, let me call this, say that this is some vector phi. Okay. So if I take the Hermitian conjugate of this whole expression, what will I get? I will get bra psi a dagger, right? And on the right hand side, what will I get? Just this, right? So this expression psi of n a dagger a psi of n, right? I can write this as some vector phi in a product with itself, right? What is this? This is the norm of this vector, norm squared. And once again, this is always greater than or equal to zero, right? So now I have the following. I have in this expression, right? So let me write down that expression again. Now what do I have? This object is greater than or equal to zero. I've just proved that, right? This quantity is also greater than or equal to zero, right? Because it's a scalar product, right? So this implies what? It implies that n must also be greater than or equal to zero, right? N has to be a positive real number, right? So we have that n is greater than or equal to zero. And this is also an important statement. Okay. Now the question is, what is the smallest possible value that n can take? Okay. So for this, we need to calculate a few more commutators, right? So we need to calculate the commutator of the number operator with a dagger with a. Let's see what this is. This is a dagger a commutator with a. Okay. Now what I will do is I will use the commutator identity that I mentioned to you a little bit earlier. Right. This is the commutator identity. So if I use this identity, what do I get? I get a dagger, a, right? This comes out on the left. And then this will come out on the right. A dagger, comma, a, right? This object is zero. And a dagger, a. And we just calculated what is a dagger, right? A dagger is one, right? A dagger is one. So a dagger a will be what? It will be minus one, right? And again, by minus one, I mean minus the identity. So the commutator of n with a is equal to minus a. Okay. Similarly, you can show that the commutator of A with N with A dagger is equal to A dagger. Okay. Okay. Again, this is one line. There's not much to do here. Now let us take this expression. Okay. Let us act on psi of n. What is psi of n? It is an eigenstate of n, right? Right. So on both sides, I put psi of n. Now this is a little bit of a trick. The first time you see it, you're like, that's very clever, right? And that's exactly where why we say that Dirac, the person who discovered this trick, all of this whole thing is a genius, was a genius. Well, because it's really, really clever. So let us work out what this expression looks like. We get n times a hat psi n minus a hat n times psi n is equal to minus a psi, right? Now, what is n acting on psi of n? Remember, psi of n is an eigenvector of the operator n, right? So, n acting on psi of n will just give me the eigenvalue times the eigenvector, right? So, I can write this whole expression as follows. I can take this expression to the right hand side. And this small n is just a number. So this operator will come to the left of this operator. So I can write n times a hat psi of n. And then minus a hat psi of n. Right? And this expression I can write as n minus 1 times a hat psi of n. Okay. Now again, this expression might not seem very obvious to you what is going on. So let us look at it again. What is the statement? N acting on a hat psi of n is equal to n minus 1 multiplied by a hat psi of n. Right? Now, once again, let me refer to this a hat times psi of n as some vector. It is some vector, right? An operator acting on another vector will give me another vector. Let me call it chi. So what does this tell me? This tells me that n acting on chi is equal to n minus 1 times chi, right? What does this tell me? This expression tells me that chi is an eigenstate of n, right? It's an eigenstate because the operator acting on this vector gives me a number. It's an eigenstate of n hat with eigenvalue what? N minus 1. Right? So that means this chi is equal to what? This chi is equal to psi n minus 1. Right? Psi n minus 1 is the eigenstate of this operator n. Right? And what is chi chi is equal to A hat acting on psi on psi of n, right? So what is the effect of the operator A, right? We have the eigenstates of, so this is some n, n plus 1, n plus 2, n minus 1, n minus 2. We have some eigenstate, right? These are all eigenstates of the number operator n. So when I act on psi of n with A, right, what happens? What happens is that I end up with psi of n minus 1, right? So what happens to the eigenvalue of the state? The eigenvalue of the state decreases by 1. If I again act on this with A, I'll get psi n minus 2. Eigenvalue will decrease, right? Yes? So if I take A dagger and multiply, act with on psi of n k times, what will I get? So this, by the way, let me be a little bit more careful. This should be a proportionality constant, not an identity. So if I act on psi of n k times, I will get something which is proportional to psi of n minus k, right? Okay. Now, remember that n is a positive real number, right? N is greater than or equal to 0, right? So now let us assume that n is equal to some m plus epsilon, where m is a positive integer. Okay. So for example, n is equal to 11.5. Anything, it doesn't matter. It's some integer plus some fractional quantity. Okay. Now I take my operator A, right, and I act m times on this state, right? What will I get? I will get psi of m plus epsilon minus m. Right? It will come down. The number of times I apply the operator, that is how many levels it will come down, right? So I'll get psi epsilon. And now remember that epsilon is a number between 0 and 1. But so now what happens if I apply A one more time on psi epsilon, right? If I apply one more time, what will I get? I'll get psi epsilon minus 1, right? And what is epsilon minus 1? Epsilon minus 1 is less than 0. It will be less than 0 because epsilon is between 0 and 1, right? So this would tell me that if I took the eigenvalue of this state, right, I get epsilon minus 1 as the eigenvalue, right? And now this is less than zero. Right? But that is not possible. Right? Why? Because remember, the eigenvalue of the number operator is always greater than zero or equal to zero. Okay. So this argument is a little bit tricky. It's a little subtle, but it's a very beautiful argument. Right? So this is not possible, right? So what is the solution? The solution is that epsilon must be equal to zero. Which means that your eigenvalues have to be one of the, it has to be a natural number. Natural numbers are 1, 2, 3 or 0, 1, 2, 3. I always forget. Well, I'll just write it like this. It has to be 0, 1, 2, 3. It has to be a positive integer. Right? So n has to be a positive integer. There is no other option.
Sir?
Yes?
From the definition of epsilon, we can take epsilon in the range from 0 to 0.5.
Sure, necessary? You can take it to be anything, yeah.
Then there, yeah. So then the allowed value of small n may be integer also.
No. Why? Epsilon is a non-integer, right? It's a number between 0 and 1. Right? If you take a number between 0 and 1 and you subtract 1, what will you get? You'll get something less than 0, no? Right?
Yes, sir.
But that is not possible because that would mean that this is an eigenstate of the number operator with a negative eigenvalue. So the only possibility is that epsilon must be equal to zero. Right? Which means that our eigenstates, our eigenvalues of the number operator must be integers. Right? Because we took it to be some integer plus some non-integral number, right? Some fractional quantity. We have shown that this must be zero. Right? That means that the eigenvalues of the number operator must be integers. Right? And what is the smallest possible eigenvalue? What is the smallest eigenvalue? N is equal to zero. And if I act on this, can I get psi of minus one? Is this allowed?
No, sir.
No. Right? So what should be the action of A on psi naught? It has to be equal to zero. Right? And what is psi naught? Psi naught is the ground state. Right? It is a state with the lowest energy. Right? Because what is the energy of my state? If you go back here, the energy of your state is h bar omega times this a dagger a plus 1/2. So if A dagger A acting on psi is zero, then your energy is 1/2 h bar omega. That's the smallest possible energy. So this is the ground state. And you can also see right away that A dagger A acting on psi naught is equal to zero, which means that E zero is h bar omega by 2. This is your ground state energy. Okay, this is the lowest possible energy of your system. But this is not equal to zero, right? Again, this is a consequence of the uncertainty principle. You remember, for the particle in a box, right? For a particle in an infinite potential well, what was the smallest possible energy? So E of n is equal to this expression, right? N square h square by 8 ml square. And what are the allowed values of n? N is equal to 1, 2, 3. Zero is not allowed, right? Because zero just gives you a zero wave function. There's nothing there. So what is the smallest energy? Ground state is what? H bar square ml square, which is not equal to zero, right? This is the ground state energy. And why is it not zero? It is not zero because of the uncertainty principle, right? So the uncertainty principle tells us that delta x times delta p is greater than or equal to h bar by 2. Now, when I put the particle inside a box, right, here, what do I know? This tells me that delta x is of the order L, right? Delta x is of the order L because I know that the particle is somewhere within this box, right? So there is a finite uncertainty in delta x, which tells me that delta p has to be greater than or equal to h bar by 2L, right? Now, if I say that the energy of the state, right, if I say that delta E goes as what? Delta P square by 2m. Let me write like this, right? Well, what will this give me? This will give me h bar square by 4 times 2, 8 ml square. What is this? This is equal to E1, no? Right? So because I put the particle inside a box, I make the uncertainty in its position to be a finite number. When the uncertainty in the position is a finite number, that means the momentum uncertainty is also a finite number. That means it is always moving around, right? And so it must have some energy. That energy is this. What about a particle in a harmonic oscillator? Well, a harmonic oscillator, this is a parabola, right? This is your potential. So once again, you are confining the particle, right? And so your energy levels look like this. Your lowest energy level is h bar omega by 2. And what is the spacing between each? Between each level, delta E is equal to h bar omega. Okay? And finally, I know that you have a lab at 3:30, so I'll just take a couple more minutes. Finally, we have this expression for the ground state, right? We have this expression for the ground state. We can actually solve this expression explicitly, right? Why is that? Because what is the expression for A? A is this quantity, right? A is this expression. So if I say A acting on psi naught is equal to zero, that means that this object acting on psi naught is equal to zero, right? And what is p hat? P hat is minus I h bar d by dx, right? So this gives me the following equation: m omega x hat plus, there's a minus I and an I, that will give me plus one, and we get h bar d by dx acting on psi naught is equal to zero. Right? Now what I can do is I can write psi naught as psi naught x ket x dx, and I can m omega, so no, not m omega, so just m omega x hat plus h bar d by dx psi naught, and this will give you that m omega x plus h bar d by dx acting on psi naught of x is equal to zero. This is a differential equation for psi naught, right? This is a differential equation for psi naught, and we can solve it. It's actually very simple to solve. This is equal to minus m omega by h bar psi naught x. What is the solution of this equation? Psi naught x is equal to exponent minus m omega by 2h bar x square, right? And I can make a plot of this. What does the plot look like? It looks like this. It is a Gaussian. Okay. You can just take the derivative of this expression and you can check that you will get this quantity on the top, right? If you just take the derivative of this with respect to x, you will get minus m omega by 2h bar, and then you have to take the derivative of x square, which gives you 2x. So the factor of 2 will cancel and you'll be left with minus m omega x by h bar times the exponential, which is sine of x. Okay? But this is not normalized. This is not normalized. So we have to put a normalization factor also. So there has to be a normalization constant. If you want to normalize it, right? Okay, so I'll stop here. So this gives me the solution of the harmonic oscillator, right? So I have the complete solution of the harmonic oscillator. And I didn't have to solve any complicated differential equation. Excuse me. Right? So, any questions? And tomorrow, or in our next class, what we will be doing is, we will be talking about this is the quote unquote easy way to solve the problem. We'll be talking about the hard way. The hard way is to write this down as a differential equation and then to solve it. And the solution gives us something known as Hermite polynomial. So we'll be talking about that tomorrow, day after, sorry. Okay? Questions? And by the way, the harmonic oscillator, right? This system, this model, this is, you can consider this to be the most important model in physics. Okay? So if you do anything like with quantum devices or quantum dots or nanostructures or whatever, or condensed matter, so you go into technology rather than research, okay? This is what you will use over and over and over again. And as somebody had asked, what is the real world application of this? So in one of the lectures this week, I will give you a real world application by writing down the Hamiltonian and showing you what happens. We'll talk about a real system that is used in quantum computation. Right? We'll talk about what is a qubit. Okay? All right then, I guess this is it. Unless you have any questions. So I'm going to stop the recording and the live streaming.